evening for the launch of the book on the artist James Fraser's view of the Himalaya Mountains. Our family has been actively collecting art for the past 100 years, and we've been most fortunate to have been able to have in our collection the work of practically almost all artists working in India in the 18th and 19th centuries. Creating a permanent record through their sketches, engravings, oil paintings, and watercolors, preserving the grandeur and sweep of our country, our monuments, temples, and most importantly for us today, the beauty of the Himalayan mountains. These collections are on display on the walls of the hotel for everyone to enjoy. Incidentally, we have been informed that this is probably the largest collection of its sort on permanent display. The idea of publishing this book actually evolved quite naturally. As these collections got more exposure, many art lovers asked us where simile prints could be acquired. As these are rare, limited edition prints, they are now very difficult to come by and expensive. So we decided to produce a new edition using modern technology, combined with hand craftsmanship, leather hand binding, gold gilding, specialized marble paper, to produce a volume as near as possible to the original album, but at a cost of less than one original print. It has been our endeavor to give a chance to art lovers and collectors to be able to possess and cherish this limited edition volume. And this has been a labor of love. It has taken over 18 months to produce. Special care and dedication has been invested, and it is hoped that all the details that have been meticulously taken care of will be appreciated. If this venture proves successful, we plan to publish periodically the works of different artists to enable art lovers to expand their collection. I now request William Dalrymple to say a few words. William is the internationally famous historian and writer who we in Delhi have taken to our hearts and who has chosen to return to his spiritual home. He has kindly written the foreword to the book, and I would like to take this opportunity to thank him for his support and encouragement throughout this project. William, please.
There are certain occasions when you must watch out what you say, and this is certainly one of them, being in the Scylla and Charybdis between talking about one of my wife's ancestors being republished by my landlady. So I can fall out with just about everyone that matters to me tonight if I say the wrong things. When I was first taken up to Olivia's family in Scotland 27, 8 years ago, we stayed on one of the first trips with a mutual cousin, actually, one who's a cousin of both Olivia and me, a man called Malcolm Fraser. And about 10 or 7 years before that, Malcolm had been rootling around in his basement when he found a large trunk. In that trunk, he found the collected letters of 5 brothers, 4 of whom had come out here to Delhi, and one of whom was an artist. And that artist was called James Baillie Fraser. He was the eldest brother, and having failed to make his career in trade in the East Indies, in the West Indies, he came out to Calcutta to try and set up an agency house and began taking art lessons with the artist Chinnery, incidentally, whose exhibition is now in Asia House in London. There's a wonderful exhibition of all his work on at this very moment. Chinnery taught James in his spare time, and in the bottom of this trunk were found James's early sketches, alongside all the letters of he and his brothers, plus a bound volume now known as the Fraser Album, which contained what's generally regarded as the most remarkable collection of company school painting to be produced anywhere in India in the 19th century. And it is the great masterpiece. James comes across in his letters as an extraordinarily interesting man. He was a man of many talents. He was a diplomat, a spy, a linguist, a writer, but also an artist. And it is as an artist, which was, I think, he would have regarded as one of the least of his talents, that he came to be remembered. He produced, in his spare time, in between his other projects, almost as a hobby more than anything else, two sets of pictures, one of Calcutta and the other of a Himalayan tour. Both of these he knocked up in between his main job, which was as a trader for the East India Company. His Calcutta pictures were based very much on the success of the two Daniels, the nephew and uncle, Thomas and William, their lithographs. And he went two brothers interfacing with the late Mughal court in a way that breaks all the stereotypes of colonial engagement. James and William both gave up eating meat. They gave up alcohol and became, according to the Frenchman Jacquemin, who passed through, he called them half-Brahmanized philosophers. And so this extraordinary image of people arriving in India, falling in love with it, painting it, commissioning poetry, commissioning the late Delhi artists. And the final achievement, I think, of James were these extraordinary pictures of the Himalayas, which Mira has just reprinted in this magnificent, I think it's called Elephant Scale book, is that not? And it is James produced both a book of travels describing that journey and an entirely separate book of lithographs, which is what has been reproduced here, illustrating it. And they remain, I think, two of the most attractive descriptions, both textual and pictorial, of the Himalayas to survive. One final strange connection. In the Fraser album, there is a picture of a Sikh gentleman. Mira, what was the exact name of? He's called. There is an Akhoi Sikh depicted in the Fraser album. So there is a connection between the original artist and the family who have gone on to reproduce the work for the 21st century. Thank you very much for having me, and thank you for doing the book. It's fantastic.
Thank you very much. I now ask Mr. Robert Hutchinson, the author of the text of this book, to say a few words. Robert himself is a frequent visitor and trekker in the Garhwal region. His introduction to the area began with the well-known environment activist Sundarlal Bahugunav Chipko movement film, whom he traveled along the Ganga in Garhwal. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I must say, when I read the invitation and my name was on it as a speaker, I said, oh, there must be some mistake, because I have to be the world's worst public speaker, which is quite an accomplishment if you consider the 7 billion people on this planet. And anyway, here I am. Just a few words. It guarantees that I'm going to be very short. I must say, Lieutenant William Webb was a remarkable man. He was the apple of the eye of Colonel Colebrook, who was the Surveyor General of India in 1808. And Colebrook said to Webb, he said, young man, you're to go up and find the source of the Ganges. You'll have all the backing of the East India Company, and you'll have the latest scientific gear, and I want you to make a few studies of the heights of the mountains up there and come back and give this glowing report. Well, Webb got up a few days beyond Uttarkashi and he decided this is not for me. This, with all the backing he had and all the equipment he had, he said, this is just too dangerous. I mean, no man can go up that high, go up to Gangotri, and maybe it's the source of the Ganges, maybe it is not. But so he said, oh, I'm going to go back with my team, except I'll send a servant up. You know, and he got, he said, the servant can join me later on, and he was going over to the Alaknanda Valley, and he can give me a written report. So Webb packed his bags and went back down the river. James Baillie Fraser with his brother, who he left, his brother was called to other duties, and so he went on his own up the Jumna River Valley, and he got to Jumanotri, the first European to see Jumanotri, and then he crossed over the watershed and into the Bhagirathi Valley, and without too much trouble, he made it alone, a Scotsman, with all he had as equipment was a compass and a wheel that measured the distance, and it got pretty mangled along the road. And so he became then the first European as well to get to Gangotri. And he did these splendid drawings and pictures along the way, and he came back down and he wrote up his journal, and it was published in Scotland, in England. And people said, no, it's not possible. I mean, this man is not a scientist. He didn't understand anything. He said he got to 17,000 feet on the spur of Bandarpunch, and he could never have made it that high. And he says that Bandarpunch, the Webb had said it was about 25,000 feet high, and Fraser, from his observation, said it's about 21,000 feet, I believe. And they said, no, no, this man is totally unorganized, not scientific, and so on. And anyway, that was, for many years, the end of the story. And the outstanding record of his visit to that area, to his pioneering visit to that area, are these wonderful reproductions that we see today. And for that, he has to be a remarkable man. I thank you very much.
The Honorable Dr. Karan Singh is the senior most statesman of our country. He's had an illustrious career, starting when he was just a young man. He's been governor, member of parliament, cabinet minister, ambassador, head of various national and international organizations, and today heads the Indian Council of Cultural Relations. He has made a tremendous impact with his contribution to the political, social, and cultural life of our nation. And within his personality, he epitomizes the best of the Indian ethos, a prince with a common touch, a scholar of the first order with humility in his nature, a statesman with no arrogance, and above all, the repository of the living, breathing cultural tradition of India. Dr. Karan Singh belongs to the hills and mountains of India, with whom he shares a very, very special bonds of his childhood and memories. And it is but fitting that he presides over today's function, where these engravings of the Himalayan mountains are once again going to see the light of day. I'm extremely grateful to you, Karan Singh Ji, for gracing the occasion. Please say a few words and then we'll launch the book.
Meera and Jasdev Singh Akui, William Dalrymple and Robert Hutchison, Parag and Ashok Agarwal, distinguished members of the audience. The quote with which the book begins is from the great poet Kalidasa. Astuttarasyam Dishidevatatma, Himalayo Nam Nagadhiraja, Purvaha Paroto Yanidhi Vagahya, Stitaha Prasidhyaiva Manadanda. He says that in the northern direction, there is a great spiritual presence. Devatatma. The Himalayas are not merely a geographical feature. They are a spiritual presence that stretches from the west to the, from the east to the western sea, like the measuring rod of the world's greatness. If the greatness of the world has to be measured, the only rod that can be used is the Himalayas. And it is true that the Himalayas has been the source of our life-giving rivers, source of our civilization, of our culture. Without the Himalayas, we would have been like Saudi Arabia without the oil. It is because of the Himalayas that we have the monsoons, that we have these glorious deodar forests, some of which are disappearing regretfully. And there are places, Mount Kailash, for example, is holy to four great religions. Jerusalem is holy to three. But Mount Kailash is holy to the Hindus, the Jains, the Buddhists, and the Sikhs. And our civilization, our Vedas, our Upanishads are all flowing like the Ganga, like the Ganges flows from the Himalayas, from Gomukh and Gangotri. In the same way does the great Indian civilizational continuum flowed for thousands of years from the Himalayas. And it is quite extraordinary. I was looking through this book, how 200 years ago, Fraser was able to capture not only the form of the Himalayas, but the spirit of the Himalayas. I think that is what's so extraordinary about this. He was not only a technician. He was a person who seemed to be, as he said, they became Brahmanized Scotsman or whatever. He seemed to have a reverence for the Himalayas. And you can't be in the Himalayas without having a reverence for them. Because they as it were, bring out in you the deeper elements of the human psyche. And he had a keen eye. He had a most extraordinary technical capacity to paint. And his paintings represent the first documented evidence of what the Himalayas looked like at that time. Not only the beautiful mountains, the temples, the people. Yeah, so from every point of view, whether it is demography, whether it is geography, whether it is history, these are a unique collection. And I must thank Meera and Jasdev for having made them now available after a long time to the general public. Somebody was saying they were very expensive, but as Meera says rightly, the whole set cost less than one of the prints would have cost. I think it's a great thing that you've done. And the Agarwals, Parag and Ashok, have really done a splendid job. I was being shown the originals and the reproductions, and quite frankly, I couldn't tell which was which. They are absolutely perfect in the reproduction. It shows how technologically improved our publishing and our printing is. It is really something, I think, which deserves commendation in every possible way. I don't want to go on about the Himalayas, but I must say that the presiding deity of the Himalayas is Shiva. It is Shiva who pervades the whole Himalayan range. It is this great concept of the Mahayogi, of the Nataraja. Shiva is a concept of many, many different forms, from the yogi in meditation down to the dance of the Ananda Tandava, all the way down in Chidambaram. He's a pan-Indian deity, and the spirit of Shiva pervades the Himalayas. And therefore, Meera, if I may, I would like to dedicate this volume to Shiva, because I think he is the one who really pervades the Himalayas. And there's a beautiful small shloka, Karpura Gauram Karunavataram, Sansarasaram Bhujagendraharam, Sadavasantam Hridayaravinde, Bhavam Bhavani Sahitam Namami. Karpura Gauram, white as camphor. Karunavataram, the embodiment of compassion. Sansarasaram, the essence of the cosmos. Bhujagendraharam, who wears the great serpent around his neck. Sadavasantam Hridayaravinde, may he, along with his spouse Parvati, remain forever seated in my heart. So to Lord Shiva, I dedicate this great book. Thank you very much, Meera.
Dr. Karan Singh Ji, should we launch the book?
Yes, we do.
Thank you. Thank you very much, and everyone in the audience, thank you. Please join us for a drink, launch of the book. Thank you for being here this evening. Thank you.